God, we thank you. Some of your alarms went off. It's 559. We're praying for Fresno. We're praying for the Lowell community. God, we thank you for another opportunity to come before you tonight, God. Father God, I pray that you would open us up to whatever you would have for us tonight. In word and in song, Lord, I pray that you would just give your people what they need, God. You know what each one of us stands in need of, Lord God. Have your way on tonight, God. Let our hearts be open to receive from you. We come expecting, Father God. So we thank you already that you're going to surpass what we even expect, God. In the name of Jesus. We glorify you on tonight, God. We lift you up, God, because you're worthy of glory and honor. All praise belongs to you tonight. In Jesus' name, we thank you. We come before you, God. We come before you, God. Open vessels, ready to receive. In the name of Jesus, we thank you, God. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, amen.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Yahweh be praised on tonight. Hallelujah. Can you just put your hands together? Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Give him praise with your hands. Hallelujah. Maybe shout out a thank you, Jesus, or a hallelujah, hallelujah. Because he's worthy on tonight. He's to be praised forever and ever and ever and ever. Hallelujah, Jesus. The enemy has no room on tonight, amen. He thinks he's running things, but he's not running nothing in the name of Jesus, all right? Hallelujah, hallelujah. He's under our feet on tonight, hallelujah. And we speak against any plan he has, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Thank you. see you.
Yes,
I wanna see you.
Sounds so beautiful, hallelujah.
I want to see you.
Hallelujah.
In my life be glorified.
You are also unmovable in our lives. Hallelujah. You stand strong in our lives. Hallelujah. And we trust you, God. We honor you, God. We trust you, God. We honor you, God. Because you're faithful. Hallelujah, Lord. You're faithful, God. When we feel weak in you, Lord, in our spirits and even in our flesh, God, you strengthen us, God. Hallelujah. You raise us up, Lord, in your power, God. Hallelujah. And God, we thank you. Hallelujah. Because you're mighty. Hallelujah. And we give you all the glory. Hallelujah. We honor you, God, above all, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We may not pray the same time every day, God. We have things we ought to work on, God. But we love you, Lord. Hallelujah. We honor you. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. We may be inconsistent in some areas in our life, God, but you are consistent. Every single moment of our lives, God, you still remain the same, and you're always there. Hallelujah. You never leave us nor forsake us, God. Hallelujah. When the enemy rises up against us, God, you are the standard. Hallelujah. He cannot come any closer. Hallelujah. That you allow, God. Hallelujah.
Yes, God.
We rebuke the hand of the enemy, hallelujah, that tries to come against us, God. Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The enemy's working, God, but so are you, God. Hallelujah. You are bigger than our problems, God. You're bigger than anything going on, God. You are mighty. Hallelujah. You are mighty. Thank you.
Good evening on ramps. How are we? Thank you, worship team.
Yes.
Man, thank you, worship team. My name is LJ and?
I'm Lindsay.
That's Lindsay. And so before we invite all our beautiful young folks up here, I think it's that time for
selfie time.
Saturday selfie! Pull that cell phone out. Thank you, Chris. Usher us in, Chris. Thank you. All right, all right. If you are in preschool all the way up into sixth grade, we want to invite you all up here. Make your way to the front. That is first steps and journey.
Come on up, kids.
Come on up, next gen. Let's go. There we are, there we are.
What's up?
Hey, I like your boots. You should do a quick kick like this so that way the camera can see your cool boots. All right. So today we have Matilda's going to be in first steps. Matilda, whoop whoop. Let's go for Matilda. Let's go. Whoop whoop. And where's Brent? And we got Brandon. Let's go. Hashtag or at Mr. Let's Go. That's him. And he'll be leading a journey. Oh, thank you, Beckham. Thank you for returning my phone. Came back like a boomerang.
Hello.
All right. So, family, will you please stand with me and extend your hands over this incredible group here? I think it's such a privilege. I was reminded like 2 weeks ago that the privilege it is for individuals to point out where Jesus is in our lives. So pray over Brandon and over Jess, over our other mentors that support in Next Gen, working with our young people. Say, hey, there's Jesus in your life right there. So let's pray over them and their time as we lift them up. Amen. So Father, we thank you again for your love for us. Lord, we thank you for your pursuits in our lives. God, we thank you that you reveal yourself to us as teacher, as king, as prince of peace. Holy Spirit, would you move again in the hearts of our teachers, in the hearts of these children? May you be with them in the classroom. May your word come to life, that it may not just be a story, but the living word. Father, we thank you. Again, we thank you, Lord. Again and again. God, do your work. Do it again, Lord. You will. God, bless these young people. Bless these students. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, amen.
Everyone. Oh, thank you. Wow. How's everybody doing tonight? Hey, and if you didn't, maybe you did this during selfie time, but hey, let's just take a minute and say hi to a neighbor. Maybe you don't know somebody who's sitting next to you. Please introduce yourself. You're on ramp, so you're around family, you know? So please, please avail yourself. Avail yourself. Amen. All right, amen. Oop. All right, wow, thank you all so much. And it's a pleasure to be here with you all. It's an honor to be asked to give the word tonight. And so I just pray right now, Lord, that you would speak. Take my words and make them into something that you can shape the hearts of people. Lord, I just ask that your word would be preached faithfully through me and just through all the different things that we've done tonight, all the ways that you're desiring to connect with us, Lord. and just revolutionizing our lives. So we thank you, and we give you honor in Jesus' name. Amen. So I am continuing with our series that we started last week? Pastor Phil? Yeah. I'm like looking for you for an answer. Like, I was there too, I promise. Anyway, the series that we're doing for the month of January is called New Year's Revolution. You might have thought it's a New Year's resolution, but it's beyond a temporary resolution. So New Year's Revolution is, we're trying to contrast, you know, the thing that we normally do at the beginning of every year, which is do a resolution. And, you know, I don't want you all to get the wrong idea. We're not against New Year's resolutions, okay? I've been getting up at 5 a.m. every Wednesday to go run around and lift heavy things with some of my friends, pretty much against my will, but I don't know. So, you know, I'm not immune from the temptation, okay? So I just want to let you know, we're not against New Year's resolutions. We like them, but the reason why we're making the contrast, the reason why we're comparing and we're contrasting is just because, you know, a resolution is like a little incremental change that you would enter into your life if you're like, my life is basically on the right track, but I just need a little tweak, you know? I just need like a little bit of a course correction, you know? And that can be good. There's a lot of areas in my life where I'm like, okay, things are all right, but I would like to improve a little bit, some incremental change. And, you know, developing discipline in your life is a really good thing, you know, subjecting yourself to stuff that you wouldn't want to do on your own. That's a good thing, right? But I think maybe we can sometimes misunderstand the thing that God wants to do in our life, which is not an incremental little change, but God wants to do a revolution in our lives. A revolution literally means to turn something around, to revolve it, to fundamentally change the trajectory of a thing. And so it is a little bit different than a resolution, because a resolution assumes that, for the most part, things are going in the direction that you want. But that is like a reform, not a revolution. A revolution is a total transformation, turning around into a new direction entirely. Jesus talks about his kingdom revolution with phrases like when he says, you know, in my kingdom, the last will be first. That's a complete turning of the way that we see who's important in the world, right? Over the Christmas season, we listened to the Song of Mary, where she says, Lord, I thank you because you have cast down the mighty from their thrones and you've lifted up the lowly. That's a revolution. This is the very thing that Jesus confronts us with, an invitation to a revolution. But that revolution maybe is different than his initial hearers expected, and maybe also that we expect. But this is the good news, right, that Jesus doesn't want to just change little things. He's not like, you mostly got it, but you know what? I'm going to give you a slightly better habit, or, you know, I'm going to help increase the, I don't know, how many vegetables you eat every day. I don't know. See, those things, like, we don't need God to come into our life for those little things. Maybe we just need an accountability partner or something to get up early and to work out or whatever it is that we've decided to do. But Jesus wanted more than that. And so tonight we're talking about relationship revolution, reimagining connection and community. Jesus, I think it's helpful to think about Jesus through the lens of him as a revolutionary because he was, but maybe just not the kind that we envisioned or that the world had a template for. The kind of change that Jesus wants to bring into the world is radical, and when we say radical, it means something that goes down and grabs the roots of something, something that engages the very core of something. So it's not a superficial or an incremental change. And Jesus said in Luke 12, he said, I've come to set a fire on the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled. Doesn't that sound like something a revolutionary would say? Amen. And so it's cool because we also just happen to be on the weekend of the week that we celebrate the life of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., another prophetic figure and revolutionary that was sent to our time and place to speak a prophetic word to our society. And so, I don't know, everybody has a little thing that they like to do during that time. And so the thing that I read this week was actually, I got to find it so I don't forget, you know. But I read, no, not there. I'm holding too many things. I got to reread, actually, the Riverside Church sermon that Dr. King preached April 4th, 1967. It was entitled Beyond Vietnam and A Time to Break the Silence, which was later published into a book called Where Do We Go From Here, Chaos or Community? So this is another interesting thing, but this sermon was delivered exactly 1 year to the day before Dr. King's assassination in Memphis, Tennessee. This sermon was kind of a turning point in his career, in his ministry, because it was the time when he started to connect some extra dots. You know, he had been working for civil rights, for, voting rights, and for different kinds of, like, local things. And he starts at this moment to connect the global dots and say, how can we stand for peace and nonviolence and justice in Birmingham, Alabama, while we're sanctioning death and destruction in Vietnam, right? And he started to kind of see the global picture and connect that. And so after this sermon took place, I read that over 167 newspapers came out. Someone wrote in there in 167 newspapers to denounce this sermon. And he was actually accused of treason for his radical critique of American imperialism in Indochina and around the world. And so, as this is like a time of year when people remember Dr. King, because I would say he's a genuine revolutionary for the kingdom of God and a prophetic voice to American society, we got to remember, though, as we like to do and is important to do, is that when kind of his memory gets sort of trotted out at these sort of official functions, and we're going to invite you all to take part of the Fresno Dr. King rally that's happening on Monday. There will be an announcement for that. But it's good to remember that he was a dangerous figure, and he was, just like Jesus, was a challenge to the powers and principalities of his day, and even still of today. He's not the kind of fluffy, sanitized civic hero that gets paraded out every year to kind of recuperate the civic and social order that he prophetically challenged so deeply. In fact, he was such a prophetic figure and such a challenge to the people in his lifetime that, let's be real, he had to be monitored and threatened and blackmailed and eventually killed, like all the prophets that God sends, right? And so it's important to remember that, he's not just like, he just said everybody should love each other, right? You don't really get wiretapped by the FBI for just telling people to love each other, okay? So I just want to I'm going to be pulling a couple quotes from this sermon as we go throughout my sermon. We'll be peppered with some very good quotes. And the first one I want to show is this one, where Dr. King says, "We can no longer afford to worship the God of hate or bow before the altar of retaliation." This is 1967, but these words are still very, very poignant for today. "The oceans of history are made turbulent by the ever-rising tides of hate, and history is cluttered with the wreckage of nations and individuals that pursued this self-defeating path of hate. We must undergo a radical revolution of values. We must rapidly begin to shift from a thing-oriented society to a person-oriented society. When machines and computers," man, and he didn't even know about the computers that we have today, all right? "When machines and computers, profit motives, and property rights are considered more important than people, then the giant triplets of racism, materialism, and militarism are incapable of being conquered." Wow, he's powerful, right? I think that, we sometimes can get used to kind of the legacy of Dr. King and kind of act as if we're all, we're all on board, right? No, but like all the prophets, he was a deeply subversive figure to the world that was around him. And it's not like we've lived up to these words that we can just go, Dr. King, we did that already, No, we have not. We have a long ways to go. And these words are still very, very, relevant. Amen? And so just like Dr. King, and just like all the prophets that God sends, and especially Jesus, right? Incremental change was not what they were looking for. They were looking to go to the root of what was ailing us and what was keeping us from achieving the things that God desired for our lives and for our world, and to go to the root of the issue. And so that's what being a radical means, is to go to the root. Last week, Pastor Phil showed us through the story of Saul on the road to Damascus how the first step of Jesus's revolution happens, and it happens when we wake up to a new reality, right? So if you recall, Saul was a zealous young man, and he was convinced that God had tasked him to round up Christians, the early Christian movement, and to make sure that that movement is nipped in the bud and doesn't go any farther, because he was convinced that he was doing the righteous thing that God wanted by persecuting the early Christians, right? And it's only until he's on the road to Damascus that Jesus appears to him in this blinding light, and he says, "Why are you persecuting me?" And he's like, "Lord, Lord, who are you?" He says, "I'm Jesus, whom you are persecuting," right? And so we have to remember that the first step on our road to this revolution that God wants to do in our lives is that we have to wake up to the fact that we're going the wrong direction. And that's what Saul experienced. So first, Pastor Phil said it was a revelation, right? He saw Jesus. He was informed of something that he didn't know. And then I would say the next step was, and Pastor Phil didn't use this language, but it's repentance, right? He was going down this one road, and he literally had to turn and change his trajectory to another direction. That's repentance, but that's also revolution, like I said, right? To revolve, to turn, to change your course of direction, right? So it's revelation. We have to go from blindness to sight. And in this case, he actually went from a false sight to blindness and then to real sight. But you get what I'm saying, right? It's revelation. You have to learn that the way that things are going right now aren't working, and we need a total transformation. We aren't going to start down the road that Jesus wants to call us to until we're ready to make a clean break with the ways that things have gone before. That's the invitation. That's the challenge that comes when Jesus shows up in our lives. And then repentance, changing our trajectory, moving into a different life path. And I know that, you know, sometimes if you come from, if you have religious ears, right, the word repentance can sound very dour or self-hating, like, oh, maybe it's just if I feel bad about myself enough. But what if we did really understand it as a responding to Jesus' spiritual revolution, to turn our back on life as it was before and to turn towards a new life? Whereas Jesus says, you know, if you want to follow me, come take up your cross and die so that you can find new life in me. We have to die to the life that wasn't working for us before we can enter into that revolutionary change. And so it has to be an absolute change. It has to be a leap of faith. It has to be like the dilemma that the person who found the treasure in the field, right? He finds the treasure in the field and he discovers it and he realizes this is the thing I've been looking for my whole life. But in that moment, he was confronted with a choice. I have to decide whether or not to sell everything I have and bet it all on this discovery. And so all of these different metaphors and parables that Jesus used bring us back to that ultimate challenge and that choice that he's laying before us. Do you want to follow me or not? No one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is worthy of the kingdom of God, he says. You have to make the choice. So, this is a challenge and a choice that I have been, anybody who's a follower of Jesus has been confronted with. But I even think about my own upbringing. The faith of my upbringing was very much in the form of reform, or in, it was a theology of privilege. So, resolutions made a lot of sense in the way that I learned how to be a Christian before I really met Jesus. I'd characterize my upbringing as things are mostly going well, so God kind of comes in to tweak the rest, maybe forgive your sins, help you be a little bit nicer before you depart this life for heaven, right? But the assumption was we pretty much got what we need. This is like a North Fresno theology. It's like a North of Herndon theology kind of thing, right? No offense, but I'm just saying, like, in the world, when you have what you need, you don't sense a deep aching desire for revolutionary change, right? And this is why Jesus says, "Blessed are the poor, for theirs is the kingdom." The people who are already on the underside of our world as it's currently constituted, they know that things aren't working well, right? And that's why all of us need to have our mindsets changed by being in a relationship with people who know that intuitively, if that's not our experience. And that was one of the ways that Jesus met me. Out of a theology of privilege and into, I guess you could say, a theology of revolution, right? So last week we learned about revelation and repentance that brings us on to the path of Jesus's revolution of the kingdom. But today we're going to talk about, like, what's the substance of that change? Like, what is the thing that we're moving towards? We learned about the turning around. We learned about the being blinded. We learned about the turning around. But now, what is Jesus calling us into, right? And we're going to learn about that through this text here in Matthew 22. So read this along with me. Matthew 22, 34 to 40 says, "Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question, 'Teacher, what is the greatest commandment in the law?' Jesus replied, 'Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments.'" So, even though the Pharisees in this text, you can see, it seems like they're going in to kind of try to trap Jesus. Even that word there that they're going to testing him, I feel like they're translating that in a kind of nice and polite way, because the word really means more like they're trying to put him into a trap. And the reason why is because, "Teacher, what is the greatest commandment in the law?" is a question that was hotly debated by the rabbis of his time for hundreds of years, really. They were always trying to figure out, like, what's the one verse that we can kind of sum up all of what God intends? You know, trying to remember 613 laws, like, that's a lot. We need a little summary statement here. And so different rabbis kind of had different approaches to that. Maybe they found different texts that they said, I think this kind of sums it up as well as it can be, you know? And so the Pharisees were kind of trying to peg Jesus into a camp. Like, what team are you on? Are you on the one that says, you know, oh, the most important thing is to be slain in the spirit, or the most important thing is to be able to read Greek, the most important thing is to, you know, preach exegetically, you know, all these little kind of, it would have been a little marker of, like, what team he was on, what kind of, you know, what kind of theological camp he was a part of. And so, actually, Jesus's initial response, to quote the Shema, Deuteronomy 6, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind." That was like a pretty standard answer, actually. They wouldn't have been like, whoa. But the fact that he added to it, then he says, and then there's a second, and the second is like it. And when in the Greek, he's not saying the second is like it, like it's next to it, like it's below it. He's saying the second is the same as the first. He's saying these are really one thing. If you love God like this, you will love your neighbor as yourself. And you can take both of these and you combine them together, and everything in the law and the prophets could be hung on this one hook here. If you understand this, you understand everything. And that's pretty powerful. That's very radical. That goes to the root of what our faith is about. And this was, you know, here in verse 37, Jesus is actually reciting what... basically what the creed of ancient Israel, Israelite faith was about. They would even say, this is the first prayer that every child in Israel was taught to say. This was kind of like the statement, you know, the vision and mission statement of being a follower of God. And they said, it's to love God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And if you understand this, then you will understand it. But think about it. Saul, when he was on the road, he was convinced that he was loving God with all of his strength and with all of his mind and with all of his soul. But he wasn't loving his neighbor. He was actually harming his neighbor, thinking that he was doing God a favor, right? And so the radical thing that Jesus does is he adds that to love your neighbor as yourself is absolutely as important. You can't love God and harm your neighbor and think that you're loving God by doing that thing, you know? And so that was a huge innovation that Jesus made, that he said this, and he kind of threw the people off. He wasn't going to be kind of put in a box like they wanted him to be. And so, yes, Deuteronomy 6 is where he gets verse 37, and then 38 comes from, where is it? Leviticus 19, verse 18. Right? So I just want to go into this text. What do I have next here? Whoops. The thing that Jesus is quoting here, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all of your mind. That was, like we said, it's a prayer or like a recitation that everyone would do day in and day out, called the Shema. And the word Shema means listen or pay attention, because it says, listen, O Israel, the Lord your God is one, and you should love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind. And then it goes on. It says, you know, remember this when you wake up and when you go to sleep, when you walk into your house and when you leave. You know, it says, wrap it around your hands and affix it to your doorposts. He's saying, like, orient your life around this one thing. This is the center of what it means to be my people, is to love God with all of your heart and soul and strength and mind. Oops, I didn't say strength. You know, we're going to get into what those words mean. But so listen. And then it says, the Lord your God is one. And this can be confusing sometimes, because I think sometimes we think, oh, God is just clarifying like how many beings we're supposed to pray to. But that's not really what it's about. Is God's oneness is about God's absolute singularity. No one and nothing is like God. And so God is in a category all to God's self. So realizing that God is the highest good, in fact, he is goodness itself. This means that following God requires that, like we said, that revolutionary kind of categorical total commitment. Purity of heart is to will only one thing with our lives, to reserve our highest allegiance for God alone. Nothing else can sit on the throne that exists in each of our hearts. And when anything else is on that throne, chaos is the result. So this is why, by the way, when we love God first, when we put God first, when we put God on the throne, when we recognize that God is one, when we love God first, we can actually love everyone and everything around us in a proper and life-giving way. Without the objects of our love becoming idols or means to our own self-destructive ends. When our ultimate end or purpose is God, we can love everything and everyone for what they are. And not try to, well, love gets messed up when we try to get our meaning or our life from something which is not ultimate, right? So think about it. Have you ever been in a relationship that turns toxic because somebody wants something out of you that you can't give as a person? They're trying to find healing in you that can only be found in God. And so they end up just kind of sucking the life out of you, you know? Relationships become toxic. If we put our work on that throne, it becomes toxic because we're trying to get something out of it that it's never going to deliver. Striving for success makes us miserable. Wanting fame or recognition makes us insufferable to other people, and actually insufferable to ourselves, if we can have the self-awareness to even understand that. Projecting our deepest fulfillment onto people or things actually pushes them away from us, because we're not at peace within. Because the throne of our heart is being occupied by something that's not ultimate. And so the revolution that we're talking about starts with purifying our motives. Jesus says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. The people who have said, God, you are the one and only thing that my allegiance is given to. That's when, Jesus says, that's when we'll see God. So that's what I think, a little bit of what it means to say the Lord our God is one. It's not just about the numerical value of how many gods exist, right? It's about the absolute uniqueness of who God is and what all of our relationship to God should be. God is not just another thing out there in the world that we pick between this thing and that thing. You know, oh, do I love my kids or do I love God? You ever notice that you don't have to choose between those things? Because God is in a category altogether separate. We don't have to, like a pie chart, divide up our love. But when we love God, everything becomes available for us to love in a way where our love for God flows to God through our loving of one another, through our loving of our neighbor, through our loving of even ourselves. When we give ourselves grace, when we remember that God loves us, we're actually able to show love and grace to ourselves. And so we can't do that if the original, that first relationship is not restored and healed, right? Everything else is going to be downstream, is going to get messed up because we're trying to find an ultimate fulfillment in something that just can't provide it. And it's not those things' fault. Everything that is an idol or could potentially be an idol in your life is not a bad thing in and of itself. Anything that you can make an idol in your life is not that way because of how you relate to it, right? So a relationship revolution is about orienting our relationships in a way that actually gives us life and doesn't hurt us. And so then it says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And, you know, these are, again, like these verses, it's like if you've heard this before, it kind of sounds quaint. Oh, my heart, my soul, you know. I know what those words mean. Do you really? I know I didn't until I looked it up, right? And it's interesting because, you know, when it says love God with all your heart, what do you think of when you hear your heart? Any thoughts? What do you think of when you hear the word heart? In this, obviously, this is a metaphorical use of the word heart, right? It's not talking about love God with the organ that pumps the blood through your body, right? What is your heart in this figurative sense? Love? Yeah. Love God with all your love? Yeah. Kind of, right? And maybe it's like the seat of your emotions. Everything you pour yourself into. That's good, yeah. Yeah, your desires. Right. Yeah. So I don't know if you've ever noticed, but some translations will say, love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And I accidentally said that. And the reason why they put mind is not in the Greek here, but or in the Hebrew in the Deuteronomy passage. But the reason why they put heart, mind, is because in the ancient world, the people, when they said heart, first of all, they didn't know that you had a mind and that you think with your mind. So they're like, you think with your heart. And you make decisions with your heart, and you also feel with your heart, and you also intend, like the intending, you know, you plan in your heart. These are all things that the Hebrew Bible says. So it's like they're using the metaphor in a little bit different way than we do, because now we know about minds. So we took all this stuff that has to do with thinking, and we put it in the brain, which that's good, but in the ancient world, the heart did all the stuff that we think of as the heart doing and the mind doing. So sometimes they'll just translate that for you and say heart and mind. But when they said heart, they mean where we think, where we experience our emotions, where we cultivate intentions, where we make choices from. So that's important. That's what we mean when to love God with all of our heart. We are thinking about God. We are submitting our emotions and our experiences to God. We're cultivating intention to honor God with everything that we do. And we're making choices that, to the best of our understanding and our ability, right, are honoring and loving God with all of those things, right? And so then, so that's your heart, you know, your soul. Oh, we all know what a soul, right? That's the thing that floats out of your body. That's like your ghostly you, right, that floats out of your body when you die, or maybe when you get hit by a giant wooden mallet. Like, I'm thinking about the Looney Tunes, right, where you're like, no. First of all, that's not how ancient people thought about it. The word soul, nefesh, really just means, well, literally it means your throat, where the breath of life comes into you and where your breath of life comes out of you, right? So this is like loving God with your whole person, with your whole physical life, with everything that you get up and do during your day, right? So, and which, that sounds a lot like strength. So then what's your strength? The word strength here is the word me'od. And it's interesting because me'od isn't really like physical exertion. It's actually the word that just means like really or very or intensely. So in Genesis, when God says, the things that I made, they're very good, he says they're me'od good. So this is just like an adverb that is meant to intensify something. So he's saying, love God with your whole very. Which is kind of funny. And when the ancient Hebrew people translated their Bible into Greek, they used the word dunamis, which is like the power of motion or energy, right? So it's just like with intensity and strength. Give it all you got, right? That's what it's saying, with all your strength. I guess that's a pretty good translation. Anyway, up until this point, the teacher of the law that is trying to trap Jesus would have been like, yeah, I've heard this before, standard answer. But then Jesus elevates it to another level by adding that Leviticus 19 quote. And like you said, right, the prophets in the time of Israel constantly were on the people. They're saying, you know, you do have this intention to worship me. You do all the festivals and the stuff, but you're not doing justice, right? Who's read Isaiah 58, right? It says, you do the fast, yet at the same time, you exploit your workers or you harm the immigrants that are in your land, right? And how can you say that you love and you honor me when you're doing these rituals for me, but your heart is not oriented towards loving your neighbor? So even before Jesus said this, he's reflecting a reality that has always been the case with God. But he's just kind of putting it together in a way that's very clear and easy to understand. The prophets were always getting on God's covenant people because they wanted to kind of use their religiosity as a substitute for loving their neighbor. They say, I don't have to love my neighbor because I show up to church every week, right? Like, I tithe and I serve on the worship gathering planning team. So, you know what? I don't have to care about what's going on in this guy's life, or I don't have to X, Y, Z, whatever it is that God is calling me to do that might be costly or annoying, any need that my neighbor might have, right? God doesn't let us get out of it that way. He doesn't say, oh, you know what? You did a really good job this year at the Festival of Booths, and you gave a really correct offering. So you know what? Don't worry about your neighbor who's there on the side of the road, right? That's fine. I know you love me. He's like, no. And 1 John says, how can you say that you love the God who you can't see when you are already giving like contempt to the neighbor who's right in front of you, right? So this connection between loving God and loving your neighbor is one that Jesus connects in an irrevocable way. There's no way we can get out of, we can't enter into the revolution that Jesus is asking us to without it revolutionizing all of our relationships, not just our relationship to God, right? And so he's saying, love your neighbor as yourself. Oh, I guess there's a little bit of unpacking to do with here. Because love, first of all, man, that's what a confusing word, right? Because I love ice cream, I love Netflix, and I love God. Well, what would that word possibly mean if we could use it all on those things, right? So we got to remember, like, love, agape, it's the commitment to the well-being of the other, willing what is good for you, and doing something about it, right? So in that way, love can't ever just be an intention that's not acted upon, right? There's no potential energy in God's love for us. It's not like God is storing up this love, and he's like, I love you so much, except I have all this stuff that I want to do that I'm not going to do, because, I don't know, I just didn't get around to it yet, right? Like, God's love always takes the form of action in the form of coming to us, entering into relationship with us. God doesn't have any wasted potential of love that he just has for you abstractly, right? All of God's love for you is concrete. And then I guess we could interrogate the word neighbor, right? Even somebody does this to Jesus, right? He says, okay, you're telling me that I have to love my neighbor. Well, smarty pants, who is my neighbor, right? And it's so interesting, right? Because the story that Jesus gives, who knows what the story that Jesus gives? What's that story? The Good Samaritan, right? So he immediately enters his hearers into a scenario where they are given the choice of whether or not to show compassion on someone society has told them to hate and to fear and despise, the other, the person who isn't worthy of their love, at least that they think, right? And so he's challenging us to say, who are the people that society has told you that it's that God doesn't want you to love, right? Who are those people over there who really deserve God's wrath? Not me, though. You know, I am worthy of God's grace. But them over there, God, you know, they got it coming, right? And Jesus is saying, okay, well, imagine that person came to you when you were lying half dead on the side of the road, right? Who's being a good neighbor? Okay, go and do likewise. It's a very, you know, that's the kind of stuff that gets you killed, right? Just in the same way, Dr. King wasn't just going around saying, wouldn't it be nice if we were all nice to each other, right? This is a subversive story, and it shocked his hearers. So the revolution that Jesus is looking to enact in our lives has to do with every aspect of our relationships, our relationship to God, our relationship to our neighbor, even our relationship to our non-human neighbor. That's what I put on the left here. Our relationship to creation changes when we enter into this revolution, right? And then even our relationship to ourself, right? I think the easiest way to think about this when we say love your neighbor as yourself, say regard your neighbor's life and well-being with the same regard that you'd give to your own life and well-being, right? If you're in a burning building, you're going to take yourself and you're going to run out to protect yourself, right? No questions asked. In that sense, nobody doesn't love themselves. They like their life. Like they, you know, it's like if you're sitting here and like, I don't know, the Acme anvil. I don't know why I'm coming up with Looney Tunes images a lot. You know, the Acme anvil, I look up and I see it falling. Like I'm going to go yoink and move out of the way. And so it's like the same self-protection you would give to yourself in a day-to-day moment. Like think with that same regard to your neighbor. If you wouldn't want them to do it to you, don't do it to them, right? I don't know if we're using self always in the same way. I don't think we need to like struggle over the philosophy of it, at least not in this sermon. But I think it's important to remember. I think I have, oh no. I'm going to read you a couple of verses, right? There's other places in the Bible that talks about loving God and loving our neighbor as ourself. Like for example, 1 John says this, "This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters." And again, the call to action, it can never be abstract. If anyone has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth. So when we take our intention to love someone and we incarnate it into action, we are loving like God does. If we let it just stay, oh, you know, I have good feelings for everyone. You know, I actually love everyone in the whole world. Well, no, you don't really. Like, there's a theologian named Gustavo Gutierrez who I love, and he has a famous quote where he was talking to somebody, and they were like, oh, yeah, I love the poor, you know? I just love the poor, just like Jesus does. And Father Gutierrez said, oh, you love the poor? Name them. Which ones are you talking about exactly? And he's like, oh, my gosh, realized. Like, oh, you can't actually love an abstract concept like that. You have to love real people, and that takes action. If you love people, but they've never met you, then according to the Bible, that's not real. That's just kind of like you have a sentimental feeling towards a group of people that you're not familiar with, you know? So he says, if you love the poor, like, tell me their names, you know? Who are the actual people in your life that you love? And if it's not that, then it's not love, right? Love is not an abstraction. Let us love not with words or speech, but with actions and in truth. The reason why we know that love takes on this active character is because we know what love is because of Jesus. He laid down his life for us. That's an action. That's a self-giving act of love. That's the essence of love. Again, another excellent passage, right? 1 Corinthians 13. Think about all the religious things we could spend our lives doing or the kind of accolades that we could cultivate getting from people, right? He says, if I can speak in the tongue of men or angels, but I do not have love, I'm only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy, I could fathom all mysteries and all knowledge. If I have a faith that can move mountains, but I do not have love, I am nothing. If I give up all my possessions to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but I do not have love, I gain nothing. And again, this is a great passage, right? Hear it at all the weddings. Think about this. If God is love, this is also a passage where you can replace every word love here with God, right? We know that this is what love is like because God was first this way to us. God is patient. God is kind. God does not envy. God does not boast. God is not proud. God does not dishonor others and is not self-seeking or easily angered and keeps no records of wrong. God does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. God always protects and trusts and hopes and perseveres, right? So if that's the way love is, and God is love, we're getting that image of what love looks like from the way that God has treated us. Again, back to the Dr. King, right? He says, a true revolution in values will soon cause us to question the fairness and justice of many of our past and present policies. On the one hand, we're called to play the Good Samaritan on life's roadside, but that will be only an initial act. One day we must come to see that the whole Jericho Road must be transformed so that men and women will be constantly beaten and robbed as they take their journey on life's highway. True compassion is more than flipping a coin to a beggar. It comes to see that an edifice which produces beggars needs restructuring. Woo! Isn't that good? Man, I love that. And then I think Caden Sky said this, actually. When we talk about love, remember, we do it from love, not for love. We don't love others because we're trying to earn God's love. We can only love others because the love of God has already been poured into our hearts. God is the one who loves us first, always. If you even have a sliver of love in your life, it is only ever a reflection of the infinite love that God has for each and every one of you. And so every time, everyone that loves is born of God, 1 John says. We can't love without God because God is love. And so it's never to earn. It's never like... you know, a wage where we say, well, if I love this person, then you got to do this for me, God. That just shows that we've completely misunderstood what's going on, right? We always do it from love, never for love. Or as one of my favorite philosophers, Simone Weil, says, God's love is not the reason for which we should love him, right? We shouldn't love God just because of maybe the love that we get from him. God's love for us is the reason for us to love ourselves. We can know that we're lovable, not because we just have to assert it and say, no, I am lovable. I'm taking this time. I'm doing self-care. Like, we don't have to like assert and fight for love, right? The reason why we know that we are lovable is because God already loves us, right? We don't have to strive to feel like we have to earn it or prove it to ourselves or to anybody, because God is the source of our love. And God already loved us. Even while, the Bible says, even though while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. He showed us the ultimate love. We don't have to earn God's love. All we have to do is receive it. So that changes every single one of our relationships. That is like the first step on a relationship revolution. And, it's so simple, right? It seems simple. I feel like we want our faith to be more complicated. But Jesus is like, no, love God with everything you have and love your neighbor as yourself. And I think that it would actually be comforting to us if, you know, Christianity was like more of an esoteric system where we had to learn like 10 different levels of reality. I think sometimes we like desire it to be really complicated because then we could get out of the radical simplicity of it. Because like Chesterton said, right, the Christian ideal has not been tried and found wanting. It's been found difficult and left untried. So it's not that I can't figure out what Jesus is all about. It's too complicated, right? We don't turn away from Jesus because it's too complicated. We turn away because we're afraid of just how simple and powerful and challenging the call to love is. If you go, oh, just love your neighbor as yourself, that's easy, right? It's like, okay, try doing it, right? Try doing it for a whole day. Try doing it your whole life. That's not something that we can do on our own strength. Every day we need to walk by the Spirit in order to hope to be able to love even a fraction of the way that God does. And so we might criticize Jesus and say, well, this is really simple, you know. I need like a deeper teaching, right, from you, Jesus. And he's like, no, I'm not going to give you a deeper teaching until you actually fully engage with this simple thing that's really, really hard, right? We really come to the end of ourselves when we think that we can do that, and then we actually try it, right? We realize our need for God, our dependence on him. A lot of times when we go deeper in our relationships with other people, we run into this place where we kind of hit a wall and we go, man, I don't think that I'm going to go any farther in this relationship unless God like intervenes in some way, like I was friends with this person, and then, you know, we got in a fight, and now I don't know what to do, right? And Jess and I were talking about this the other day, like the stages of community that we go through, and we go through as individuals and as a church, right? A lot of times we're very polite with each other. We're very happy. Oh, I'm blessed and highly favored. How are you, you know? And it's like, that's nice, until we start to really rub up against each other and notice the ways that we're different from each other, the ways that we see the world differently, and the way that we get under each other's skin because we're really different. Up until that point, maybe we were sort of projecting. I was like, I love you because you're basically like me, you know? We're seeing a reflection of ourselves in the other, and it's easy to love that reflection. But once you start to get to know people, as you go deeper in community, you start to realize the depth of how we're different from each other. And that can be an opportunity to despair and to say, I can't do this. You know, they're all really different from me. We're not the same. We don't have all the same opinions about everything. We don't like all the same stuff. How am I supposed to love these people, right? And once we get to the end of ourselves and we empty all that stuff out, then God can fill us with a true community, a true way of relating to each other that's not based on what I get out of it, but then it's just a reflection of the love that God has for that other person. And I can say, even though you're so different from me, even though we don't even follow God the same way, like we don't understand like our faith even in the same way maybe, but we have the same God loves both of us, and that can be the source of our friendship and fellowship. And I think that that is the place that God is calling us to. So we think about, like, what does this look like in the life of our church, right? What does this look like for us? Like, what does it look like to go deeper in a revolutionary changing of directions in our relationships with one another? I think it's about having the humility to be honest with ourselves, with others, with God, and to say, like, our ability to fellowship is not based on our politeness or our ability to be nice friends or our ability to know what the kind of churchy cliches are, but really to put into God's hand the trust that says, I'm going to lay it on the line and really try to enter into fellowship with these people who sometimes weird me out, you know? I'm not speaking of, y'all don't weird me out, I'm just saying. But, you know, if I were to get into this situation, this is what I would say, right? But, like, we really need to trust. Loving our neighbor and even just loving our friends is actually so much deeper than we kind of give it like a very, oh, that's simple, right? But this, it's the thing that's going to take the rest of our lives to figure out how to do. And if we really give it the intention that it deserves, it's going to be a lifelong journey of going down to the roots. And we're going to discover so much about who we are. We're going to discover so much about who one another is. And so I just want to end just with this exhortation that we're in a season of transition as a church right now. And so I think God is calling us to go deeper in every single way. Like, God needs every single one of us to be who God called us to be in this season so that we can be God's people together, so that we aren't looking to somebody else, we aren't waiting for someone else's invitation, that we're saying yes to the thing that God is calling us to. We're bringing our whole self to the table. We're trusting the gifts that God has given us to bring everything that we are to the table called community, to this task of being the church, right? God is calling every missional member of OnRamps to become engaged, serving in different places, right? Of course, but I think more deeply, being ourselves around each other so that other people can enter into a real relationship with us, not just the church version of us, right? Even with our full messiness, right? If we think that God can't handle our true selves, then a lot of times we can't be our true selves in front of one another. We have to put on kind of a church-approved facade, you know? And that's not going to take us to the levels of relationship we need to operate as a body. And so that's our invitation, a relationship revolution looks like us having the confidence in God's love for us that we can be our true selves to one another, we can extend grace and receive grace from one another, and that we can put up with the fear of what might happen if we were truly ourselves around each other, right? That's the only way we're going to move to that next level where we can be God's people together and not be a crowd of spectators, but really a family and a healing community that's healing its community. So this is the revolution that Jesus is beckoning us towards. This is the thing that Jesus is saying, come here. This is the direction, the trajectory I want to train. I'm going to train you on a different trajectory, right? This is the thing. So may it be so, right? Let me pray. Lord Jesus, in the same way that you blinded Saul on the road to Damascus, would you just encounter us In all the different ways that you do, Lord? Would you show us all the places in our lives where we need to turn around? Would you point us the direction to go? And then would you walk alongside us as we walk? We know that you are the great physician, the good shepherd, the rabbi and teacher of our lives, and we need your guidance. in this season, when we're going into uncharted territory, Lord, we need your guidance. We need your strength and encouragement, but we need all of our relationships to be revolutionized by your Spirit, God. And so would you make it so? Would you do it in our community? Would you just change all the relationships that constitute our neighborhood? Would you bring shalom, which is a flourishing of relationships, into everything that we do, God? And would you just walk alongside us and give us guidance and wisdom through the whole thing? We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Well, thank you all. And here's the Marianos.
Thank you, Pastor. That was so encouraging.
Revolutionship.
I know. I like that. That's sick.
I'll use it. Hey, everybody. Yep, we're the Marianos, and we're back up here again. All right. So here's an invitation. Every Wednesday morning at 6 a.m., there is an incredible group of people who look like the Power Rangers. Look at them. They are transforming. But there is an invitation to come work out with the morning workout group Wednesday morning. You know, it's a great time for community to let down your guard and be extremely tired. If you ever want to know what a zombie looks like that loves Jesus, come Wednesday morning, and they'll come alive. All right. Come talk to Seth afterwards if you have questions.
All right. Next, we've got Tuesday night Bible study.
Yay!
At 6 p.m. We do dinner first, potluck style, so bring a dish if you would like to share. And then this Tuesday, we're doing an optional outdoor walk or indoor activity, so come dressed for that. / if you're going outdoor walk, make sure you're bundled up because it's cold.
Yes, it is so cold. Well, you know what else is happening? 7 days from now, men's breakfast in the activity center. Woo. Let's go. So 8 a.m., January 20th, men, brothers, invite your friends, your brothers to come join for a really good time for encouragement, worship, prayer. It's a very wonderful time. So mark that on your calendar.
All right, next, I am so excited about this. Martin Luther King Day March, Monday at 9:30 a.m. We'll be meeting, or it's at St. John's Cathedral. Pastor Erik mentioned this during the sermon. Our family's planning to be there. We hope whoever wants to come shows up. It's super cool. So there is, that's happening on Monday.
Yes, and pull your phones out and look at those people pointing at us. So as a member of our pastoral search committee, we met this past week. We had a really encouraging time, family. Talking about all of you, not like behind your backs or anything, not like that, no. More so about, as Pastor Erik had mentioned, we are on a new journey in the life of on-ramps. And in our conversation that we had this past week was that we can't move any further in this conversation without everyone's input, all right? We're not gonna make all the decisions all by ourselves. So in part of doing so, in the next couple of weeks, there's gonna be an assessment given out asking for your feedback for the missional members. However, if you're not a missional member yet, and I do say yet, an opportunity will come, and you do wanna know what's going on, use that QR code. Your question will take you, it will take you to a digital parking lot to where you can submit as many questions as you can, all right? And it'll ask you to put your name because we might wanna have some further conversations in this journey, all righty? Also, we got you. That was the tagline, we got you. So we're working really hard and praying that we go through this process well in serving our community.
Cool. We want to invite you to pray with us. If you want to take your phone out and set your alarm or make your spouse do it and then just pray when they do, because then there's not two alarms going off at the same time. But we invite you to pray for Lowell at 7:01 a.m. For the 9701 area code. Pray for Fresno at 5:59 p.m. And then pray for on-ramps, not just the building, but like our church in general, at 8:27 p.m.
Excellent. Oh, and this is a reminder for Whole Life Giving, an invitation to give, to invest in the work that we get to do here at OnRamps in the community, in Lowell. The tablet's acting weird right now. I don't know what's going on with it, but there's other ways to give, such as PayPal or Cash App or Venmo or by mail or in person. Person's fine because we get to see you when we're here in the week, during the week.
Awesome. And lastly, if you want prayer, we have our elders on duty over there in the corner. And so please go over to them. They would love to pray for you. So take full advantage of that awesomeness over there.
One last announcement. If you would all be so kind.
Oh, yeah.
Please grab a chair on your way out. Get a friend. You can grab chairs together. You can work out and grab multiple chairs at the same time.
But many hands make light work.
Many hands make light work.
Happens fast.
Blessings, everyone. Have a good night.